Good morning, church family. This morning's a very special morning, and I'm sure most of the children will know why it's special. It's special because it's Father's Day. So if you're a dad out there this morning, I hope you have a wonderful day. I hope your children have spoilt you already with breakfast in bed, with a nice cup of tea or coffee. Maybe even bacon and eggs. But if not, I'm sure they'll spoil you today. So have a wonderful day and many blessings on you. So I think a lovely way to start is just to pray blessings on all the dads out there this morning. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for our earthly dads. We thank you for the blessing that they are. Father, we thank you that we can call upon you as our Heavenly Father, but you have blessed us with dads that can give us wisdom and guide us through life here on earth. And Father, we just pray for all the dads out there this morning, a special blessing over them. Pray that you would encourage their hearts, especially for dads that have just become dads, the new dads. Father, I pray that you would give them a real encouragement and blessing this day. So, Father, I just lift all the fathers before you. And for those who may not have dads or have lost their dads, Lord, I pray for those as well. And, Father, I pray that you would really be with them this day as they think about their own dads that may have already gone to be with you, or, Lord, that they just don't have an earthly dad here. So, Father, we just ask for your rich blessings upon all the dads out there this morning. And we do commit this time to you on Chine, Lord Jesus, and we ask that you would guide everyone participating in this morning. So we thank you and we give you all glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so this morning, there's several things that we've got to go through here. And obviously it's Father's Day. So the first thing I will mention is that we have a few little testimonies from four very special dads in the church, from different ranges of ages. So we'll hear from them a bit later. They're just very short little testimonies of what it's like to be a dad for them. So we'll hear from Howard and Roland, from Nick, from Braden a bit later on. So thank you guys for sharing and look forward to hearing from you. Now, Katerina is actually going to mention quite a few of the notices this morning, but one thing I did want to highlight is our prayer and fasting week that has actually been postponed because of our election being postponed. And the reason for this prayer and fasting, obviously, this is a crucial year for New Zealand as we look ahead to the future. And we do have some huge issues this election that we do have to address. And I'll just hold up this magazine. This is called Election 2020. And these are some of the issues that we need to be addressing and praying for before we vote. So obviously we've got the abortion, which is already an act. But we can be praying into that because we do have the most liberal abortion laws in the world, unfortunately. There's euthanasia, the cannabis law, and obviously there'll be many other issues that are on your hearts. So I do encourage you all as a church, all of us as a church, to really consider the prayer and fasting week. Now, fasting, you might shudder and think, I've never fasted before. Well, fasting doesn't have to be a full fast of food. There's lots of things that you could consider. Obviously, it has to be a sacrificial thing for us to give up. After all, this is coming before God and seeking Him and putting aside those things that we may enjoy on an everyday basis. So these are just some ideas for you. You could fast on these things, sweets and chocolates, difficult for some. Or, especially if you're a bit younger, or even our age group, or a bit older, you could fast on this. No cell phone for a week. Who could cope with that? Or, television. Another good one to actually take a stand and say, no, I'm not even going to consider to put the TV on this week. Or coffee, tea, or even other your staples. Just, it could be a full fast as long as you follow the fasting criteria of drinking plenty. That's really important to drink. It could be a partial fast, giving up a meal. maybe a lunch or a breakfast or a dinner. Just give up a meal for one evening. It could be many other things. Ask the Lord, pray about that leading up to the prayer and fasting, and seek the Lord and ask him, what can I give up for a week for you, Lord, as I press into you and seek your will for our nation. So I just wanted to highlight that to you, because we will be asked to actually vote in a referendum for the cannabis law, to bring in either the cannabis law or the euthanasia. So these are really, really big issues. So this, I believe, is a very important election for us to consider. So I do encourage you to be praying and thinking about that. So our prayer and fasting week starts on Sunday the 4th of October and goes through all week to Friday the 9th of October. So it would be really fantastic if you could really consider this leading up to that prayer and fasting week. Okay, so on my list, the next important thing is the birthday box, which we don't have. So all of those who've had a birthday this week, we will make sure that you all receive a chocolate. For those who've had a wedding anniversary, likewise, we'll make sure that you get a chocolate. So next time we gather together, which God willing will be in the near future, you will all receive your chocky. Just come up and get one out of the birthday box. So we won't forget you. So on that note, I would really love to pray for you if you've had a birthday or an anniversary this last week gone. Heavenly Father, I thank you for birthdays. I thank you for wedding anniversaries, Lord. And Father, each one of these events are very significant and special to us, but more so to you. So Father, I just lift up those who have had birthdays. I pray blessings on each one. I pray that you would continue to steer them and grow them through this year. Even though this year's been a bit shaky, Father, I pray that your hand of grace and guidance would be upon them. So I thank you for birthdays, and may you bless each one who has had a birthday this week. And Father, likewise with wedding anniversaries, I thank you for the gift of marriage, and Father, this is a gift, and Lord, I pray that those who have celebrated a wedding anniversary this week, you would just bless them, that you'd be the third quarter of their marriage, that you continue to protect them and watch over them, Lord. And we do pray for protection over all our marriages in our church. So we just bring these things before you in your precious, mighty name. Amen. Amen. And I think on that note, we can go on and hear the testimony of these amazing dads in our church. And I think they may have a wee note of wisdom for those who are pending being a dad or, in the near future. So God bless you all. Have a wonderful day, daddies. And my daddy's here too, which is even more special. So I will spoil him as he always gets spoiled. So God bless everyone. Have a wonderful day, dads. Cheers. I have one final notice. It's regarding the assistant pastor role. We are just about ready to advertise for the assistant pastor, which is very exciting. The core committee have come to this point, so we would be encouraging all as a church family to be praying for just these coming weeks ahead, for obviously wisdom for us to be selecting the right person for this role. If you feel that there is something really impressed on your heart, a person in particular or a scripture, or a word that would be really helpful
to the core committee or to the elders or Richard, please let us know and speak to one of the elders or somebody in the core committee. So that is pending, that is coming up, and the church will be informed as we advertise fully for that. So please be praying, and God bless. Have a great day, and we look forward to hearing from Kirsty.
Yay, notices, everyone's favourite time. If you want to give online but you don't have our bank account details, you can email reception or you can just contact us at the church office. All giving qualifies for a rebate. We're still together as a church community, but it may look a little bit different at the moment. Please reach out to us at the church office so that we can support you and encourage you in any way. We invite you to join a Digs group. It's the best way to socially distance and still be connected at this time. If you want more details, contact the church office or email reception@morrinsvillebaptist.com. If you have any prayer requests, feel free to text them to 020-4183-3751 and the prayer team will join with you in prayer, faith and agreement. Another way we can stay connected with you is through our church newsletter. If you're not receiving our electronic newsletter, please contact the office to give us your current email address. Please feel free to join us as we gather online for corporate prayer every Sunday evening on Zoom from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. God deeply desires us to spend time with Him in prayer individually and corporately. If the people of God are spiritually healthy, it enables us to be more effective in worship and mission. If you want the Zoom login details for this gathering, please contact the church office or again, email reception@morrinsvillebaptist.com. And this is another opportunity for us to gather in prayer as we seek the Lord for His will in New Zealand ahead of our country's upcoming election. This is going to be a week of prayer and fasting starting on Sunday the 4th of October through to Friday the 9th of October. Will you be able to join us for this? As usual, we'll have links to the kids' services for this week available on our website. And now I'm going to hand it over to Bronwyn to tell us a little bit about what's going on in the budgeting service.
Hi everybody, welcome back to my office. Here at the food bank, things are getting really busy. We're seeing record numbers of people coming through requesting help with food. And my shelves are getting a little bit empty. So, just putting the word out there, even at alert level 2, we are still open for business. And if you want to donate food, you're welcome to bring it into the front office and you can leave it out there for us. And we'll make sure it gets to families who really need it. And thank you so much, guys, because I know you're amazingly generous. And during these times when people are in trouble, that's when people of Morrinsville come together and we help people. So thank you, guys. Remember my shelves, and God bless you all.
I've been asked to give a brief talk on what it's like to be a dad. And there's a lot of highlights, perhaps, but one of the things I liked most of all was watching them grow up. And they would start school and get into sports, and we were able to help them with that, encourage them, and then they would start to learn to do things, and we were able to help. They went to high school, and that got them into some sports teams. That some of them, one of them performed very well at rugby. And one of my sons performed quite well at hockey, so we were able to help them with those things. And even in as they got past the teenage years, there was things that we could do to help them and support them. And to me, that was the highlight of being a dad, was being able to help. Now, the other thing I was asked was to find a funny moment. Well, I couldn't really think of one of those, as it's a long time since we've been together as a family. But the one thing I could think of was a happy time that the boys got a trampoline. They were asking for one, and money was quite short at the time, so I told them there wasn't much hope. But then I learnt that my brother's brother-in-law worked for a manufacturer and could get one wholesale. So we got it, and I chased the two older boys down to help their mother milk. What I did with the other two, I don't know, but I got it assembled without them realising what I was doing, and then we brought them up to see the trampoline. Well, they had a lot of fun with that for years and years and years, and that was a really happy moment. And the last thing I've been asked to do is to, what advice would I give a young dad? Well, the first advice I would give is to show your children that you love their mother. That, to me, is one of the most important things you can do. Show them that their mother is loved and respected. And make sure that the children know that you want them to respect their mother and obey them, and obey her. The last bit of advice I would give is sometimes you have to make very difficult decisions. Don't shy away from making them. Sometimes the children will resent them, but you know much better than they do what's best. So never back down from making a hard decision that's in their best interests. And finally, when you're having a problem and you can't seem to get on top of it, consult the Bible, and Proverbs 22:6 is a good place to start.
Hey guys, so Judy's asked me to talk about being a dad. Seems it's Father's Day, and I thought I'd have a go at just going ahead and doing the video without reading the questions that she sent me, or without actually taking some notes, because I figured that's a good way to be honest. So being a dad, it's good. That doesn't probably sound very convincing. It's great when they sleep. That is definitely true. But actually, that is it's the best thing we've ever had. 100%, it's challenging because you basically have no life. You sort of get these snaps of time where you can actually just do nothing. It takes approximately 3 months to finish watching a film on Netflix. But you know, I wouldn't actually give that away for anything, because our two little boys are our entire world. They're our little pride and joy, and we wouldn't give them back for anything. They make you smile. They definitely make you cry sometimes, but not me, of course. They make you laugh a lot because you very quickly learn to see yourself in your children. And that's kind of scary, because you realize what you sound like or what you say. That's quite funny. Enough about that. Anyway, bit of advice. My poor children are going to end up going to school and their dad's going to be the principal. So if they watch this video in the future, boys, I apologize. But a bit of advice for any dads or potential dads out there as an educator. Absolutely, 100%, the best thing you can do to your kids is talk to them. Don't get yourself panicky about TV or anything like that. TV's fine, just not too much of it. But talk to the kids a lot and read to them. Read every night before bed with every kid, because that will give them such an advantage when they start school at age 5. That's without a doubt the best thing you can do for them. So yeah, good luck. Happy Father's Day to all you fellow dads out there. And yeah, stay strong.
Hi guys, Julie's asked me to share some stuff on being a father. She sent some questions through, so I'm just going to fire through them. And yeah, so one was what I love about being a dad. At this stage of life, when I've got two kids that are young, what you love is maybe you wonder in between the sleepless nights and the constant work that you put in, but it's real enjoyable to see them developing and them growing up. At the moment, they're starting to interact with each other, which is really cool to see. So that's something I enjoy. My words of wisdom and funny story kind of tie together. Word of wisdom is, I think, put the hard yards in while they're young, and it'll pay off in the future. I'll find out whether it works for in the future or not at a later date, but when your kids are screaming and grumpy and you're tired and everything else, it's real easy to just say yes and take the easy way out. But I think it's, if you can put the hard yards in then and actually put some foundations down, it will pay off for them when they're older, and it's way easier now when they're young and at later stage in life. And my other one is, ties into my story, is that the other week we've taken a tree out, and me and Peyton were out in the yard cleaning some wood up, and something flew up and hit me in the face and landed in my mouth, and the natural thing is to spit it out. Well, that is if you're not a vegan, I suppose. And anyway, we just carried on, and then a couple of days later we were out there again, and here Peyton was trying to spit. Luckily she wasn't succeeding, 2 and 2 wasn't making 4. And anyway, it just reminded me that kids are sponges, and everything you do, they see and they watch. It was 1 second of something I just did as a natural reaction, and she noticed. So yeah, it's just, you've always got to be aware that what they see, they're absorbing. They'll be there for the good things and the bad things. So that's my bit. Thanks.
Hi everyone. I guess Father's Day's coming. That's probably why we've been asked to have a few words. Here I am, sitting on the couch eating my ice cream, and that's pretty good. It's good having been a parent, and it's quite good to reach the stage now where we don't have any kids at home, and I can sit back and enjoy this period of life. However, being a parent, what was good about it? Well, that's a question we've been asked. And I would suggest to you that, for me, it's not a suggestion, for me, was watching the kids move through the various stages of life. Just as a calf, you know, gets born, feed it milk, it's weaned, moves up, becomes a yearling, becomes a heifer, becomes productive in the herd. The same sort of thing with the children, you know, watching them go through those stages, whether it just be achieving potty training, yahoo, first few words, off to kindy, whoop whoop, off to school, playing the rugby, whatever. It's very, very satisfying watching your kid move through the stages. And regarding advice to any young dads out there who are going to be dads, don't be afraid to be the boss. Both parents have been given the job of training up the kids, and you know, to do that training, you have to be the boss. Can you imagine training a dog when you were half sure about whether you had the right to tell the dog what to do or even give it a clip? It's like that's also my mother-in-law always said. She said, if you can't train a dog, you shouldn't be a parent. I wouldn't actually know how to train a dog, so what would I know about dogs? However, I have seen it with children, that when they're very young, you should expect unquestioned obedience, really young. And then as time goes on, you take your foot off the throttle a bit, and you don't be so dictatorial and in your control of the kids. However, you are still the boss, and you will remain the boss for many, many years. So don't be afraid of that role, and make sure that you're wearing the pants when it comes to relationships with little kids. And as you grow, hopefully you'll have a friendship develop with your kids, but you'll always be the parent. So yeah, there'll always be that respect sort of thing, that set relationship between you and your kids. And may that work out really well for you. Be the boss. See ya.
Kia ora whanau. Foster Kelmer here. I've been given the privilege of leading communion this morning. A devotion I've been doing recently on spiritual warfare had one day completely devoted to communion. And have you ever considered that communion could be a weapon against our enemy? Come on, let's get out of the office and go find somewhere quiet so that I can explain to you. Imagine there's two armies. They're armed and they're ready to fight, prepared for battle. One army fights for good and the other for evil. The tension builds as each side anticipates the first strike. Because of his firepower is limited, the evil commander, he must rely heavily on the level of fear and intimidation that he can inflict. And just as he's about to order the attack, the righteous commander just walks out into the middle of the field between the two armies. Well, he sets up a table full of delicious food and drinks, and he invites his officers to come and recline beside the table and enjoy the meal with him. Well, seeing the good commander and his men resting and enjoying a meal with his enemies present, and that completely unnerves the evil commander. You see, his key weapon, intimidation, is useless because the righteous soldiers are confident and fearless. To make things worse, the items on the table symbolize the evil commander's most humiliating defeat. You see, that's the covenant meal that God prepares for you in front of your enemies. It has a powerful effect on your enemy and upon you. The covenant between God and his people is a solemn oath. You give him your allegiance, and he gives you what he's promised. When David asked King Saul for permission to face the giant Goliath, he pointed out that the Philistine didn't have a covenant with the living God. That was in Genesis 17:2. David recognized that his own covenant relationship with God guaranteed him victory, even though the odds appeared to be against him. David's confidence wasn't in his sling and his stone. It was in the promise that God had made his people, that they would possess the land of their enemies in Genesis 15. That was. So in Luke, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And he said to them, "This is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." So when we do this, when we drink the wine and eat the bread, we need to remember that the death and resurrection of Jesus took away the devil's right to touch you. Your spirit is safely hidden with Christ in God. That was in Colossians 2:10-15. and 3, 1 to 4. So whenever you take communion, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until his return. That's from 1 Corinthians 11, 24 to 26. To proclaim is to claim something beforehand. And this means that when you partake in communion, you put forth a claim on all the things that Christ's death purchased for you. And when facing the enemy, you let your confidence rest in your covenant with God. Because of this covenant, you can deny the enemy access to your soul and body as long as you stay away from his idols. Once again, that's in Colossians 3, verses 5 to 10. So I just welcome you all to think on those things as you take communion this morning.
Let us pray. Father, we welcome you. We welcome you, Jesus. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Father, I just surrender every prayer that I'm praying today into your hands. And I ask that, Holy Spirit, that you will guide me. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all your benefits, who forgives us from all our sins, who heals all our diseases, who redeems our life from the pit, and who crowns us with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies us with good so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. Thank you, Father, for your amazing power and your work in our lives. Thank you for your goodness and for your blessings over us. Thank you that you are able to bring hope through even the toughest of times and strengthening us for your purposes. Thank you for your great love and care. Thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you that you are always with us and will never leave us. Thank you for your incredible sacrifice so that we might have freedom and life. Father, as we come before your throne of mercy, we submit our spirit, our soul, and our bodies for you for examination. Remind us that repentance is very powerful because it puts us in a position of being forgiven. Because when we are forgiven, this takes power away from the enemy over us. We know that the enemy cannot stand it when we repent. And the enemy knows that this is the way for you, Father God, to intervene into our lives. We confess and repent of the sins from our hearts, our mouth, and our mind. Father, forgive us for offending you. Holy Spirit, forgive us for grieving you. Father, forgive us for partnering with the lies of the enemies that has been playing in our minds, in our hearts, and our emotions. Forgive us when we don't thank you enough for who you are and for all that you do and for all that you have given. Father, I ask that may you not judge us according to our sins, but according to your mercies. Help us to set our eyes and our hearts on you afresh. Renew our spirits. Fill us with your peace and joy. We love you and we need you from this day and every day. We give you praise and thanks, for you alone are worthy. And Father, we uplift all the fathers and the grandfathers as it's a special day today, celebrating Father's Day. We pray a blessing over all the fathers and the grandfathers with the best of your spiritual blessings today. Let him know that he is not alone in the tasks that you have given him to provide for and support those under his care. Show him how much you delight in his work and affirm the value of whatever you have given him to do, both as a father or grandfather. Confirm his worth daily and let him know that he is loved in the eyes of you, Father God. Create in him a deep sense of trust in you, knowing that he can count on you to help him lead and protect those dependent on him. Let him know that every unselfish act of love and encouragement he has offered has been a gift that you have received gladly. Show him how effective his prayers are and what a difference he can make to those around him, no matter how big or small is the assignment. When challenging times push him beyond his limits, assure him, Father, that you can take him further into the realm of possibility. Speak deep into his spirit the powerful words that he longs to hear from you, that nothing can ever separate him from your love, God. Help him to grasp firmly the promises of your word, standing with faith on the things you declare are true. Reward him for his faithfulness, past, present, and future, assuring him that true success and satisfaction don't lie in his accomplishments, but in the steadfast, Christ-like character that you are forming in him. Demonstrate to him your amazing grace and forgiveness as he seeks to love and to know you with all of his heart, with all of his soul, and with all of his mind. Release him from unwanted burdens of false guilt and bless him for his willingness to keep short accounts with you, forgiving both himself and others. Help him to see his children or his grandchildren through your eyes, realizing that in your hands is the safest place they can ever be. Strengthen his confidence in you and that knowing that you can bring good out of any situation. Teach him how to meet the needs of his children's life that are within his ability to do so, but help him to trust you for the rest. Push out any needless fear and grant to him godly wisdom and spiritual guidance to lead and direct those precious children in your path, knowing he must also release them into your hands with prayerful love. Complete any healing of past hurts or regrets that may interfere with his parenting styles to his children. Build in him a sense of joy, humility, and playfulness that draw his family close. And when plans don't develop as he hopes or dreams are not realized, open his eyes to see beyond this world to a greater joy that never disappoints, and to a father who will never leave or abandon him or his loved ones. Give him a passionate faith and persevering spirit, and a powerful testimony that overcomes any weakness or doubt as he wears your armor daily. Father, I pray also for the single fathers out there, whether they are raising their children alone or even if they are doing the best they can with the time they have. We pray for strength, protection, wisdom, and discernment to help them through whatever trials they may be facing. Thank you, Lord, for these men, and guard their hearts and their minds in Christ Jesus, that you will meet all of their needs and that they may experience your peace that surpasses all understanding. Father, I uplift every grieving father into your throne of grace. Lord, they're going through a lot of pain after a loss of a child, and it is not easy for a father to bury their child. But Father, we know that you are their comforter, Father God. We know that you lavish them with your love and fill the void left in their hearts with your unconditional love. Father, we say in Psalms 100, verse 4 to 5, enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. We give you thanks, Father. We bless your holy name, for you are indeed a good, good Father. Your steadfast love endures forever, and you are faithful to all generations. We ask this in Yeshua's powerful and precious name. Amen.
Kia ora whānau. I just wanted to say that. Did I sound convincing, right?
Yeah, that's good.
Cheers, man. I won't say leshgau or anything like that. I'll stick to my thing. Hey, we are here in our little slice of Argentina. We're here at Casa de Antores, okay? And one of the cool things about this period of time was we've been able to cruise around some different places and hang out with people and do some worship. So got Ruben here. I was too late. I was going to get him to bring his sax, but I thought about it like 5 minutes before we were supposed to get here, so it didn't happen. But anyway, we got what we got, guys. So enjoy. This first song, some of you know, some of you won't. It's easy enough to pick up. God, it's good to give you praise. Yeah, Father, we thank you that when you when we give you praise, Father, there's something about our burdens that just is lifted because we put you on the throne.
Oh, praise the Lord.
sort of this funny thing right now, because I'm sort of like, I want to pray over you guys, but you're not right here, so I'm sort of like having to jump in this time machine. And I pray that God's presence is real. It's real difficult to do this with the video. You know, there's no substitute for being together with your brethren, eh? But God, I just pray that your spirit would move in these lounge rooms that people are sitting in right now. Father, I pray you give encouragement to those who need it right now. Father, I really pray for comfort. There's plenty of people that need that. We thank you that you're so willing and generous to, Father, to extend yourself in your presence.
Good morning, Church Whānau. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Kirsty. I always feel privileged when the opportunity arises to present a message. Today's message is an introduction to hope. Hope is personal to all of us. We all have individual desires of our hearts given to us from God. The topic of hope carries much joy, and hope deferred brings heartache. So in some ways, the topic of hope can be raw and close to home, as I believe it is for many. This morning, I pray that we can collectively learn a thing or two about hope and understand God's purpose for it in the Christian walk more fully. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13 states, "And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love." Over the past few weeks, we have learnt that love is the foundation of the gospel. Love is the basis of everything that God is. We recognise that we are to believe deeply with all that is within us that God is love, and to trust and yield wholeheartedly to Him. We serve a faithful God. Our faith was revealed in what God has done at the cross through Jesus, and will be continued to be evident in His promises stated in His word that are yet to be revealed. Hope, when positioned next to love and faith, can seem whimsical, slightly vague, and a bit wishy-washy. The way in which modern language is used tends to lessen its meaning. I hope the weather clears up. I hope it rains. I hope you have a wonderful day. The word hope in ordinary English vocabulary is generally distinguished from certainty. When we read the word hope in the Bible, in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 13, "Set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ," hope becomes certain. It becomes clear that it is so much more than wishful thinking. We know that there is a profound connection and a close relationship between faith, hope, and love. The combination of faith, hope, and love are the core ingredients of the kingdom at work. Let's explore hope's role in this special trio. It is said that hope is what links love to faith. Hope breathes life into faith. True biblical hope is based on the righteousness and trustworthiness of God. Biblical hope is a definite hope to enable us to endure life's challenges. So what might we hope for? We all have aspirations, dreams, and expectations for life. The fulfillment of what we may perceive to be the naturally occurring events for certain ages or stages of life. We may be hoping for reconciled relationships, to get married, to have children, to retire in a certain place, to establish certain securities for our family, to build something, to be part of something that reveals Jesus to many, to model steadfast living and leave a legacy for those that follow after us, to achieve a certain level of success within our careers, and ultimately to live a life full of joy. A key that I have discovered about hope is that hope understands that destinations have pathways. I would like to share two stories. The first one is called Hoping for Gabby. Many of you will be aware that there is a significant age difference between our two daughters. For 7.5 years, Greg and I faced high highs and low lows as we continued to hope for another child, a sibling for our firstborn daughter, who desperately was praying for some child company at home. During these many years, we had to ride the storm and cling to the hope in God that He had the bigger picture, that He is bigger than the circumstances that we found ourselves in. Matthew chapter 12, verse 21 says, "And in His name will be the hope of all the world." This was a verse that resonated within me and brought me comfort. This was unknown to a close friend of mine who knew that I was struggling to maintain hope, and she gave me a gift. It was this mug. Okay. And on it is that exact verse. Some days I could have a morning coffee from this mug, with confidence and even excited expectation of what may come. On other days I was doing well if I could read the verse from it, and then there were days I had to push it to the back of the cupboard, still knowing that the words on it were true, but not being able to look at it due to the pain. Obviously, in this instance, our hope for another child was revealed. When Gabby was born, as a statement of how important hope is, and how God's hope got us through our journey of loss and infertility, we chose to name her Gabriella Hope. We wanted to gift Gabby this name to let her know how deeply her family hoped for her, and how deeply she can hope in God for a future. I learned that hope trusts in a God of tomorrow. His word says that He works everything together for good. The waiting prompts us to lean in with expectation, calls for us to surrender our souls. Hope allows us to remember the promises amidst the pain. Hoping for a vision to reach fruition. There have been other scenarios that we have been hoping for that haven't yet come to fruition. Visions and ideas that appear to have a clear pathway, that would demonstrate God's love to many who would benefit from it being carried out. And for one reason or another, traction has been lost, resources are not in reach, and therefore opportunities are missed. Years and years pass by and still no further progress has been achieved. It is in these scenarios that we realise that sometimes dreams and aspirations are realised, sometimes they are not, or sometimes the process is so much slower than we can think that we think we can bear. It is in the last two scenarios where we need to be wary, as every now and then the storm clouds of bitterness, negativity, disillusionment and discouragement can begin to press up against our hearts. When this happens, all those clouds can hide or block our hope, making way for the perfect climate for hope deferred. What threatens hope? Proverbs chapter 13, verse 12 says, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life." Hope deferred is different than delayed gratification or a slight disappointment with something that hasn't quite gone to plan. It's the stuff that deep-set groans are made of. Death by a million cuts kind of stuff. Deferred means to put off, drag out in a long, drawn-out process. C.S. Lewis has a description from The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe that aptly depicts hope deferred. It's winter in Narnia. Always winter, but never Christmas. Proverbs 13:12 can be significantly difficult to digest. The hope deferred scenario can be an extremely dangerous and vulnerable place to be. As in this state, we can become spiritually dried up, bitterness can seep in, and we become vulnerable to the enemy's attacks. Satan is set to demoralize us. He wants to paralyze our minds. If this occurs, we cannot function as a Christian. We cannot operate in faith and love. So how do we cope with this heart sickness of deferred hope? Paul writes in Romans chapter 5, verse 3-5. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. When we adopt this into our thinking, we realize what is truly required to produce hope. That each stage sets about developing us to be more like Christ. And this is why hope is so important. We also have the Holy Spirit within us to guide us. We are not expected to do this alone. Hope carries a responsibility. In our suffering, the question needs to change from "Why, Lord?" to "What is this for, Lord?" Hope grows us and refines us. An analogy of hope that has also helped me in difficult times is that of an anchor. The anchor is a reminder that Jesus has me anchored in him, anchored securely in the foundation of God's love. Just as an anchor secures a ship, Jesus secures our soul. He wants to be our anchor in the storms of our life, and he longs for us to be connected to him. Another reason demonstrating why hope is so important. To realize and appreciate the anchor, we need to feel the storm. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and steadfast. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. How's that for one of God's unchanging promises? An anchor prevents the ship from drifting due to wind or current. Hope holds us. It grounds us. It guards us against the drift and prevents us from becoming shipwrecked. Just as an anchor which holds a ship is not in the exact place as the ship itself, our hope is not in this world, but it is in a sacred and greater place. Christ has gone before us to secure our salvation. We can have confidence, and this confidence can lead us to greater faith and growth in love and truth. So how do we protect our hope? Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 says, "Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." We must ensure that those nasty storm clouds don't overwhelm us and cause bitterness. We know that if we lose heart, we lose hope. Because everything flows from our hearts, we must also guard our minds. We must ensure that we consistently put on the helmet of salvation for protection. We are armed with the most hope-filled book ever written. That demonstrates many people's inspiring journeys of hope. We see their character and perseverance developed. We protect our hope by clinging to God's word and learning from those that have held on to his promises in the storm. Our hope is protected when we allow ourselves to be teachable and be guided by the Holy Spirit, praising and worshipping God, looking to him instead of looking at the circumstances we are in. This also guards our hope. So how do we share hope? Our Lord wants nothing more than his gospel to be heard by all. He wants every soul to come to know him as their personal Lord and Saviour. We are called to spread the good news. Therefore, our own hope must be intact so that we can demonstrate Christ-likeness to those around us. Paul de Jong states that we are called to be the carriers and the investors of hope into others. He also shares that our hope needs to be treasured and guarded so that the following does not occur: lose heart, lose hope. Lose hope, lose harvest. In conclusion, if someone asked, "What are you hoping for?" how would you answer that question? You could answer it in various ways. Yet Scripture teaches us that Christian hope is not based on some aspirations or goals, though there is nothing wrong with having them, but our hope is centered on a person, Jesus Christ. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, "I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy place." Over the coming weeks, we are going to dig deeper into learning about hope and discover how we can make sure it is firmly anchored in Jesus, our Saviour, our God. Otherwise, you may be tossed around in life's storms. Jesus's promises are based on the good news of that he was once dead and is alive, who is from everlasting to everlasting, and he holds the keys to the future, the keys of eternal life. Have a good week.